Good morning. I'm Pastor Ray Pichette, and I'd like to welcome you to the East Pasco Seventh-day Adventist Church worship service. We are delighted that you are tuning in. We pray today that each worshiper will be drawn closer to God as a result. Today is a very special Sabbath, and you know why? Well, the truth is every Sabbath is special, but today it's especially special because today is World Pathfinder Day. And today we have some of our special church pathfinders with us today, and they'll be participating in our worship service. So I'm very excited. Welcome. A few announcements. A few weeks ago, I announced that starting in October, we would be providing an adult Sabbath school class. Well, this past week, we got down to brass tacks trying to figure out exactly how we could do it, and the truth is we don't quite have the technology that we need to do it as well as we would hope. So we're going to hold that off for a little bit longer. Speaking of Sabbath school, our children are very, very important, and I know our parents at home are tuning into special Sabbath school programs all around the North American division. And so parents, this announcement is for you. If you have found an excellent Sabbath school class online, something that is being streamed, let the pastoral staff know, either text or email Pastor Ricky or myself, so that we can publish that and share that with other parents, maybe who haven't found something really outstanding for their children. So if you would do that, if you would help us help others, that would be greatly, greatly appreciated. Right now, I want to invite a beautiful young lady to come up and join me. Yvonne has an announcement.
They say many hands make light work. As you can see, I have a spade and I have clippers. There is landscaping around our church, and I need help. I want to keep it beautiful. I have preened everything. I have weeded some, but I need help. My hands just can't do it all. So this coming Wednesday, if you happen to be off from work, and I happen to be, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. or so, we will work on it. And I will have ice water. That's what I can promise. But we'll just work on it. And I will look forward to your help. Thank you.
Thank you. The landscaping around the church is beautiful. Amen? Yeah, we're really, really pleased with how it's coming out. This is God's house, and we want to glorify Him by making it beautiful, making it special. So your help would be appreciated. Now, we are looking forward in the near future to announcing when we will officially be open. But one of the things we have to do between now and then is fix our air conditioning. Everybody wants the church to be warm in terms of fellowship, but cool in terms of temperature. And so this church is a little over 20 years old, which means all of our AC units are about 20 years old. We have really gotten our money's worth. The Lord has blessed us. But right now, there are several units that need to be replaced and several more that need to be fixed. In fact, the price tag is $21,500 to do it. So it's a big ticket item. So the Bible says, ask and you shall receive. And James, the brother of Jesus, said, you don't have because you don't ask. So today, I am asking for our members and our friends to contribute in a very significant and special way so we can repair the air conditioning. So, see what you can do. I have a very sad announcement to make. One of our precious members has passed. Jim Wurrell has passed. I believe it was yesterday. And his precious wife needs our prayers, and that is Louise. So let's lift her up. This is not a surprise. Jim has been sick for some time now, but it doesn't make it any easier when a loved one, when a spouse passes, goes to sleep in Jesus. So please lift up Louise and the family, would you? Thank you. We continue on Wednesday night our prayer meeting series. That is Wednesday at 7 o'clock right here. We do it live as well as live stream. And so we want to encourage you to participate in that. That'll give you a real spiritual boost during the week. So let us pray. Dear Lord, we are so excited that it's World Pathfinder Day. Lord, we love our young people, and we ask your special blessing on them. And Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit would help us today to worship Jesus in spirit and truth. Help us, Lord, to honor him and glorify him. So Lord, thank you for the privilege we have of worshiping here and providing worship around the world. So bless us, draw us closer and closer to you, for we ask it all in the marvelous, dynamic name of Jesus. Amen.
Isn't that beautiful? Thank you, Chris. And thank you for your faithfulness, your commitment to God. This morning, I invite you to stand and let's sing our beautiful hymn that we've been singing for this Holy Spirit series, or theme song, number 262. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. Amen.
Good morning. I don't believe that the Lord is interested just in our 10%, nor do I believe that the Lord is interested in just 1/7 of our time. God isn't interested in fractions. He is interested in our total being. For example, Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will open the door, I will come in to him and fellowship with him." The Lord wants our hearts. And when he has our hearts, he'll have our time, our talents, and our treasures. Please remember the need that the pastor has just expressed about our air conditioning. It's going to take all of us working together to be able to come up with that $20,000+. I invite you to bow your heads as we have the prayer for the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask a very special blessing upon this congregation and those that are streaming in. I pray that the funds will become available so we'll be able to get those new air conditioners and be able to worship together soon. Be with us now as each one gives according to their heart's desire. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Do you know what I'm holding in my hand? This is called a newspaper. And newspapers have been around for a really long time. They've been around even longer than TVs and even longer than radios. And we use newspapers as a way to get information about what's happening in the world around us. Do you know what this is? This is a Bible, and it's also full of information for us. And it's been around even longer than a newspaper. Now, sometimes people call Bibles the good news. And the reason that they do that is because it's filled of stories about God and about Jesus and how he died on the cross so that we could go and live with him in heaven someday. And we're going to talk about a story that happened in the New Testament, and it's about the Holy Spirit. There was a group of Christians sitting in a room, and all of a sudden the room was filled with what felt like a rushing wind. But it wasn't the wind at all. It was actually the Holy Spirit, and it was rushing in so that it could fill them so that they could spread the good news about Jesus. And they did just that. So they went around and they told anybody that would listen about Jesus and the good news and things that he had done. And the most incredible thing happened. No matter who they talked to and no matter what language they spoke, those people could understand those Christians spreading the good news. And it wasn't because they knew the languages of the people they were speaking to. It was because the Holy Spirit was helping them. And that is the most amazing thing, because that meant everybody that wanted to hear about Jesus could hear about him. And we're so lucky. And that's because we have the Holy Spirit and the Bible. And all it takes is a prayer to God, and we can ask him for the right words to share the good news about Jesus with someone. Isn't that incredible?
If you are able, I invite you to kneel for our morning prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, our nation needs your help in many, many different ways. There's fires out west. Some of us have families out west. And Lord, I pray for all of those families, millions of acres of trees and landscape now burnt, homes that have been destroyed, lives, people who've been shattered because they have no home to go to. Here in the east, we have hurricanes, floods, tornadoes. Lord, bless our nation, bless these individuals. All of this during the pandemic, where 200,000 people have died. Be with the scientists who are exploring ways for a vaccine where we'll be able to receive this vaccine and be healthier and happier. Lord, I pray too for Louise and her family now that they've lost Jim. They need your sympathy and comfort in a very special way. So touch their hearts. May you give to them the same comfort you gave to Mary and Martha when Lazarus had passed away. Bless us as we worship here together, all of those that are being able to stream in with us. Touch the pastor with your spirit so that we'll be able to learn more about this divine person of the Godhead. Lift our spirits, I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
shaking. And though our words are mourning, our hearts are still the same. Loving any language, straight from the heart, pulls us all together, never apart. And once we learn to speak it, all the world will hear. Loving any language, fluently spoken here.
We teach the young our differences, yet look how we're the same.
We love, to dream our dreams, we know the sting of pain. From many grass to lessons, the farmer loves his land. And daddies of them misty eyes, to give their daughters hands.
Oh, maybe when we realize how much there is to share,
thank you so much, Pathfinders. Did you notice their beautiful smiles? I'm sure they were. Even their masks, by the way, are official Pathfinder masks. They looked sharp. They sounded great. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. These are great young people. Well, let's sing together. And I'm going to say that again. Let's sing together our little prayer song.
Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Come in your strength and your power. Come in your own gentle way.
Amen. Thank you. What are some of your personal, significant, life-changing experiences. Your birthday, of course, is when it all started. That was life-changing. That's when you were born. That's when you began. How about the day you got your driver's license? Now you were free to roam, I was going to say the country, but probably your neighborhood, as long as you put gas in the tank. How about your birthday? Now that's a life-changing, not only life-changing, but eternal life-changing experience. That's the day when you proclaim to the world that you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. How about graduation? That was life-changing. If you're thinking right now about college, that meant your life changed from being a student to now being a worker, being gainfully employed. That was a radical change. And then, of course, one of the big, big, significant life changes that many of us have gone through is called a wedding day. What are some of the significant life changes that take place for the Christian in general? Well, of course, creation. Creation is where it all started, where life began on this planet. And then when I think of radical, significant changes, I also think of Adam and Eve in the fall. I mean, from sinlessness to now a world of misery, death, all kinds of problems. That original couple really blew it. They really, really messed things up, and that impacts all of us. Christ's incarnation in his life, of course, is a big part of that solution. Jesus coming to this earth, being born, think of that, God being born a human. Humanity and divinity together. And of course, having said that, Jesus was born to die. And of course, he then had a life-changing experience on the cross of Calvary to make the atonement, to make our eternal salvation possible. And of course, the resurrection, which the Apostle Paul tells us is our hope. Not only did Jesus die, but the grave, death could not contain him, and he rose again. And then, of course, 50 days later, up in heaven, the enthronement of Jesus Christ to be seated at the right hand of God the Father and to be given all authority in heaven and on earth. That was significant. And, of course, at that same time, exactly at that same time, the gift of the Holy Spirit, we call that Pentecost, he came down to this earth in a very remarkable way. And we're going to talk a lot about that today. And I can't help but think of one more significant life-changing event that Christians are going to experience. And that is the second coming of Jesus Christ, the parousia, when Jesus Christ returns in all of his glory for the great and glorious family reunion. I can't wait. I can't wait. As Elder George Carpenter was going through all the different challenges there are in our nation, I kept thinking, I think God is trying to tell us something. What did the church, the body of believers, look like before Pentecost? The church, of course, was small. How many were there in that upper room? 120? So the church that Jesus had created and formed on this planet before he left was very, very small. But we would have to say it had great potential, right? It had potential. Christ had risen from the grave. This, of course, gave them incredible hope. And it certainly gave them a mission. So what did they do? Well, John 20 tells us. They went fishing. Peter and the other disciples went fishing. So while the church was small, while it had potential, it didn't have a lot. It wasn't doing a lot. And of course, what it did have, which is extremely significant, it had the good news of the gospel, the good news of salvation. They had a message. They had a message that they needed to give to the world. But so far, that message was just in their heads. Just in their heads. The New Testament books had not been written yet. There was no grand and glorious evangelistic plan developed. They were basically stuck in neutral. It was like sitting in your car at a stoplight. You're stuck. You can't go forward, you can't go back, you're just stuck. You're waiting, you just simply can't move forward till that light turns green. The church, again, had potential, it had the gospel, it had a small core of very committed and dedicated volunteers. Yes, but let's face it, the church had no power. No power. It was like being stuck at home after a big storm where your electricity goes out. Isn't that miserable? No power. You can't turn on the radio. You can't turn on the television. You can't even turn on the light switch so you can read. Or it's kind of like being in your car on the side of the road having run out of gas. You remember having that experience? Ah, why didn't I check the fuel tank? No power. That car is not going anywhere. But what did the church look like after Pentecost? The church was now filled with the Holy Spirit. The church was now courageous. The church was now powerful. Pentecost made all the difference in the world to the early church. The coming of the Holy Spirit was the secret to success. Jesus had given his disciples very clear instructions. He had given them what someone, and I don't know who that one is, but they called it the Great Commission. Here it is on the text, on the screen. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching these new disciples to obey all the commandments I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. The Great Commission. Now, it's great that they had very, very clear instructions. They were given a very specific mission. They were to go everywhere and make disciples of everyone. Excellent, clear instructions. Have you ever tried to put together a piece of furniture from a box without clear instructions? Extra parts, not enough parts. How frustrating it is to try to do something without clear instructions. So praise God, the disciples had very, very, very clear instructions. But at the same time, how incredible were those instructions? Again, how many of the disciples were there? About 120. And you're supposed to take the gospel all around the world. 120. That had to be scary to those first believers. Those first disciples must have thought, prior to the coming of the Holy Spirit, that this was truly mission impossible. Jesus, I'm sure, understood that his mission would be impossible except for one thing. And that one thing was the secret. I've been calling it the secret sauce. The secret of success is the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. The disciples of Jesus would never ever be alone, and they would never ever be helpless or powerless. While Jesus had commanded his disciples to go to everyone, everywhere, and make disciples, he first said to them, but don't go until you have received the gift of the Holy Spirit. Luke 24, verse 19 gives us this instruction. And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised, but stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven. The Holy Spirit was the secret to success. Another passage that tells us this is, of course, from Acts chapter 1, verse 4. Once, when he was eating with them, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised. As I told you before, John baptized with water, but in just a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Was Jesus telling his disciples that the coming of the Holy Spirit, the first Pentecost, wasn't he telling them how critically important this would be? And then, of course, Acts 1:8. To me, this is the key text that outlines the plan for the disciples under the direction of the Holy Spirit. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses of, to me, in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So here's the bottom line. It's very straightforward. It's very simple. It's not complicated. No Holy Spirit, no power. But with the Holy Spirit, there will be glorious, life-changing power. Jesus knew that the Great Commission would truly be possible with the power and presence of the Holy Spirit in the hearts and minds of those first early disciples. So what's significant about the very, very first Pentecost described for us in Acts chapter 2? The first Pentecost, of course, is history. It happened in Jerusalem 50 days after the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. The first Pentecost is a historical fact. The Holy Spirit descended down to earth into the hearts and minds of those first believers, those early disciples. So what happened? Well, first of all, their lives were radically, and I mean radically, changed. Prior to the coming of the Holy Spirit, they were hiding. They were hiding, waiting, but they were hiding. And now, because of the Holy Spirit, they were now courageous. I'm going to read now Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Let's hear it from God's Word. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then, what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. So, Holy Spirit is poured down on the disciples, and their lives are radically, radically changed. The early disciples, of course, had a mission given to them by Jesus to go everywhere to everyone and make disciples. Now they were given the power to do that. Now they were given the ability to do that. And notice what it says in Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 5 through 8. At this time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. "How can this be?" they exclaimed. "These people are all from Galilee." Listen, people back in that day didn't travel a lot. There was no Duolingo on their smartphones. So the point is being made, these people are all from Galilee. In other words, how can they possibly know these languages? "And yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages." Next there in Acts chapter 2, 12 different countries and people groups are described. See, those early disciples, small in number, about 120, were given the gift of the Holy Spirit, given the gift of tongues, and they were now able to speak all these different languages. Again, the point is that the Holy Spirit came upon them, fell upon them, filled them for a reason. And that reason was to fulfill the mission of Jesus Christ of going everywhere. Now they need to speak in those languages. To go everywhere to preach the good news of Jesus Christ as missionaries. Verse 11, this point is repeated a second time, which is, of course, significant. "And we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about," and here's the purpose part, "about the wonderful things God has done." Those early disciples were now equipped to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ in all the world. The falling of the Holy Spirit, receiving power from God, was not so they could pat themselves on the back and say, "Look at me, look what I can do." No, 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 no. They were now prepared to fulfill the mission. The Holy Spirit comes and fills Christians today in order to fulfill the mission of Jesus Christ. And it's still the same mission. The issue that was raised there in Jerusalem, 50 days after the crucifixion, there on the day of Pentecost, was why? Why? Verse 12, they stood there amazed and perplexed. "What can this mean?" they asked each other. Peter stood up to address this important question. To answer the question, Peter quoted the prophet Joel to explain the amazing phenomenon of what was happening. Notice what Joel says. "In the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my Spirit, even on my servants, men and women." I'm pausing for a point. "Alike, and they will prophesy." Biblical scholars agree that Peter's application of Joel 2 is appropriate. Let's face it, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that inspired Joel, was quoting from Joel appropriately. However, those same scholars say, but this is only a partial fulfillment. Joel started this prophecy by saying, in the last days. The point is, Peter was trying to say, it was predicted that the Holy Spirit would be poured out on God's people. And there in Jerusalem, that was a reality. So, Peter's answer to the why. Why is this happening? What's going on? Peter's answer is, the Holy Spirit has come. The Holy Spirit has arrived. That's the reason. That's why this is happening. Folks, Jesus had to ascend into heaven, be seated at the right hand of God the Father, so that the Holy Spirit could descend to the earth and fill the early church and ultimately prepare them for their mission. And the biblical book of Acts describes the incredible success of the early church because the Holy Spirit was now the head administrator of the early church. You know, the traditional name for the book of Acts is Acts of the Apostles. It's not a great name. It's really, truly the Acts of the Holy Spirit. I encourage you to read it. I encourage you to get excited about what can happen when the church is filled with the Holy Spirit. The next thing that's significant about the first Pentecost, the day of Pentecost there in Jerusalem, was this. God's church was really born. God's church was really born. 3,000 people became followers of Jesus Christ that day. Augustine called Pentecost the church's birthday. And in a sense, it is. Here you had a small group following Jesus. And now, all of a sudden, from 120 to 3,000 in a day, that is quite an amazing event. Acts 2, verse 41 says, those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. The early church, because of the filling of the Holy Spirit, grew by leaps and bounds under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. Acts 4, 4. But many of the people who heard their message believed it, so the number of believers now totaled about 5,000. And what's so fascinating is 5,000 is impressive, but the truth is it says about 5,000 men, not counting women and children. If there were 5,000 men, how many women do you think there were? Probably 5,000. 5,000 men, 5,000 women, how many children? Probably 10,000. I mean, you're talking that the church just exploded with growth because of the Holy Spirit. This truly is amazing. And of course, as you know, when any organization, and I'm talking about the church, when it grows that much, that rapidly, you don't have systems in place to take care of everybody. This radically changed society. And of course, we read there in Acts chapter 6, verse 1. But as the believers rapidly multiplied, I want you to remember that word multiplied, there were rumblings of discontent. Yeah, the distribution to the widows of food. The Greek women weren't getting enough. It wasn't getting there on time. So there was an infrastructure challenge. But the point is, the church was now rapidly growing. And of course, the first text I read talked about 3,000 being added to the church daily that day. Now, we're no longer adding to the church. We're now multiplying within the church. The church is growing like wildfire. The disciples, filled with the Spirit, with the ability now to communicate in multiple languages, they were witnessing about Jesus. They were telling their experience with Jesus. They were describing their relationship with Jesus. The Holy Spirit then was convicting those hearts. that we're hearing the gospel. Repentance took place. Conversion took place. Peter proclaims now in Acts chapter 5, verse 32, we are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, who is given by God to those who obey Him. Yes, it's so incredible, and it's so wonderful to see and to know that so many lives of so many people there in Jerusalem were transformed, were changed. So the first Pentecost really was amazing. What about the second Pentecost? What about the second Pentecost? Well, the reality is I probably better define what the second Pentecost is. This is our individual or personal Pentecost. This is when you and I say yes to the Holy Spirit. This is when you and I invite the Holy Spirit to take control of our lives, our minds, and our hearts. Call it baptism of the Holy Spirit, call it the filling of the Holy Spirit. All these are synonymous for one another. Friends, you are free to make this wonderful decision on your own. You are not dependent on anybody. You are free as a free moral agent to make that decision, to make that choice. The sooner the better, of course. But the point I'm trying to make is you are not dependent on anyone else. Your pastor, your elder, you're not dependent on anybody else. You are free to have that personal Pentecost by inviting the Holy Spirit to come into your life. So what's important about that? Everything. Everything. Let me share some of the blessings. Number one, you would then have the presence of the Holy Spirit living in you. Imagine that, God dwelling in you because of the choice that you have made. This brings, of course, a new and vivid consciousness of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. 1 John 3, verse 24 says, and we know He lives in us because the Spirit He gave us lives in us. John was talking about Jesus. See, when the Holy Spirit makes His home in your heart, He brings Jesus. He brings the Father. There, John talks about this in his first letter, about the fellowship that we can have with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It's a beautiful thing. Secondly, with God's presence comes victory over besetting sins. Sins that you have struggled with, that you on your own cannot get the victory, now that the Holy Spirit reigns, you will get the victory. Spiritual gifts, or I've gotten ahead of myself, the fruit of the Spirit, which of course is Jesus' character, love, joy, peace, goodness, faithfulness, all those wonderful nine characteristics that describe the character of Jesus will now, over time, be developed in your life. Friends, I know you are so loving and lovable. But if you invite the Holy Spirit in, you will become even more loving and lovable. So I encourage you to do that. And then not only does the Holy Spirit start producing the fruits of the Spirit, but He also starts gifting you with spiritual gifts. And these, of course, are given for you to help God's church complete its mission of making disciples of everyone, everywhere. The mission hasn't changed all through these 2,000 years. I love this quote from Christ Object Lessons. Page 419. Listen carefully. In the great and measureless gift of the Holy Spirit are contained all of heaven's resources. It is not because of any restrictions on the part of God that the riches of His grace do not flow earthward to men. And I'll add women. If all were willing to receive, all would become filled with His Spirit. Isn't that delightful? So what, my friends, is the condition? Willingness. Willingness. Your personal Pentecost is only a request away. Lord, come into my life. So we've talked about the importance of the first Pentecost, the second Pentecost, which is our personal Pentecost. What about the third Pentecost? The Bible calls this the latter rain. Well, you'll have to wait till the next sermon. And I'll take the whole sermon on this vital topic, because now it's talking about Joel's prophecy of in the end of time, my spirit being poured out in an incredible measure on God's people. I can't wait. I can't wait. So, in conclusion, the first Pentecost is historical. It's a fact. It's a reality. It happened. It was dramatic and unique. The Holy Spirit appeared powerfully in Jerusalem and birthed the church. The early disciples' lives were radically changed and transformed. Now they could go forward with power and passion to fulfill Christ's mission. The second Pentecost is personal. You and I can invite the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and transform us by His power and His grace. This incredible life-changing experience is ours for the asking. So I have to make this appeal. Have you personally invited the Holy Spirit inside your heart and your mind? Have you yielded control of your life to the Holy Spirit? It's your choice, and only you can make that choice. But I would encourage you to make that incredible decision today, and then every day in the morning before you start your day. Friends, don't miss the next Pentecost. Amen. At this time, we have something very special. I want to invite Mary and Lara Laxton to come forward. We have a special music, a special appeal song for all of you right now. I know you will enjoy it. So good to have Lara home.
Spirit, rain down.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lara. Thank you, Mary. Our music has been so beautiful today. Thank you, Pathfinders. Thank you, Chris. Your offertory was wow. Thank you. Lord, thank you so much for the promise of your powerful presence. Use us to expand your kingdom. Use us to fulfill your mission. Use us for your glory and your honor. For we ask this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.